Okie doke, I don't know where you're at, but this is a hasty movie, I say again, hasty. I just threw this together in 90 minutes, and I tried to be, I'm not exactly sure what bits you're missing, but here, let me animate some of this for you here. Let me do playback, and where is it here? View, toolbar, playback. There we go. All right, so this is a real quick thing. I'm not sure what we have to focus on, so I just gave you the whole schmozzle. There you go. All right, so I wasn't sure what elements of this quadratic section you weren't sure of, so I just did the entire thing. I haven't done this in 10 years. Thanks. This was fun. All right. So we got these quadratic equations. Now, quad in Latin means square. All right. So, yeah, we used to hang out in a quadrangle when I was at my college. We had this square garden that was called the quadrangle. So it's a polynomial function. It's a bunch of crap added together, and it's got a square in it, right? There's no cubes. There's no square roots. There's no reciprocals. It's just something with a square and then lower exponential powers, all right? So it's called a second degree or a quadratic equation, right? All right, so let's do it, all right? So, of course, I hope you know how to graph a parabola, right? You take a quadratic, like here's plain Jane, y equals x squared. It doesn't get any simpler than this. Here you go. All right, so we're going to do a table. All right, so we're going to do a table, and we're going to take an x. I'm just going to pick a couple x's, and I'm going to square them. All right, boom, boom, boom. There you go. Pause and do this if you want, right? And I'm just going to plop those points there. I got a 0, 0, a 1, 1, a 2, 4, a 4, 16. Here they go. All right, boom, boom, boom. Wow, look at that. And then I'm going to go to the negative side over in this quadrant here, quadrant number 2, all right? So then we go, okay, now don't forget when you square a negative, it's still a positive, right? So squaring negatives is still positive. So look at that. There is the plain Jane parabola, right? It's a parabolic curve, right? And it's got a vertex. Then it happens to intercept the x-axis right there. It happens to intersect the y-axis at the same place. It's got a line of symmetry. What's Tango Foxtrot, what he's talking about there? All right, so let's try this one. Let's try a different quadratic function. All right, so this is a quadratic function or formula. All right, let's do x squared minus 10. All right, so I'm going to do kind of like 0, 1, 2, 4, and negative 1, 2, 4, and 0, 0 minus 10 is negative 10. Can you follow all this? Right, am I going too fast? Right, maybe I'll slow her down a bit. All right, and when I plot those dots, guess what I get? Boom, boom. It looks like that. Notice it's kind of the same shape. It's the same parabola. Or it will be, but everything just got dropped down 10. So by sticking a subtract 10 on the end, all that happened was all the y's dropped by 10. Well, that's a transformation thing. That's a different unit. All right. So being able to recognize how things are transformed is something different. In any event, you probably noticed that it was really just the plain Jane, but it just got dropped down by 10. All right. So plain Jane went like this, and it dropped down by 10. All right, so what else was in there? All right, so can you notice, make sure when you do this, it's not negative 2 squared, it's negative 2 squared. There's a difference between negative 2 squared and negative 2 squared. So make sure when you're evaluating negative numbers that you put them in brackets. As a general rule, you should probably always put numbers that you're evaluating in brackets. And then they stand up like a dog's balls, right? That you can see what you're doing. So this was the x that we were changing. All right, there you go. All right, so that takes care of that. Oh, now, what have we got in this shape here? All right, so I'll plot the left-hand side there. Well, notice I made a mistake there, right? 4 squared is 16 minus 10 isn't 4, it was 6. And I noticed I had made that mistake because when I went to plot the dot, it didn't look right. I went, that doesn't look right. Because it should be a parabola. It should be symmetrical. It should look the same on the right as it does on the left. And I noticed the mistake here because it wasn't going to quite look symmetrical. Notice there is a line of symmetry. Boom, straight down through the middle, straight down through the vertex. Guess what? If you know the equation for the vertex, well, then you know the line of symmetry. So in this case here, notice that the line of symmetry goes boom and straight down the y-axis where x is 0. And you can kind of see that, right? Because look, here's where the x is 0. Everything to the left looks like everything to the right, right? If you go one step to the left, it drops 1. If you go one step to the right, it drops 1. All right, so, well, increases 1, rather, right? Because going from negative to less negative is an increase. So you can see the symmetry there. You can see the vertex. So there's how graphing them works. Well, you know what? In the real world, you're just going to put them in a graphing tool, right? If you're doing this in applied math, there's a graphing tool called Desmos graphing tool, desmos.com/diagonal calculator, but you're not allowed to use that, right? You're not allowed to use that in pre-cal, all right? But in applied math, you just type that on your phone and then you touch these dots here and the answer pops up. All right, so let's do that, all right? So notice if we did x squared plus 4x plus 4, right? You could evaluate the table yourself. In pre-cal, you got to do your own table though, right? So let's see. You'd go 0. 0 squared is 0 plus 4 zeros is 0 plus 4 would be 4. So a 0 gets you a 4. Yeah. How about a 1? 1 squared is 1 plus 4 ones is 4 plus that 1 is 5 plus 4 makes 9. Yeah. How about a 2? 2 squared is 4 plus 4 twos is 8. So that was, what did I say that was? 4 and 8 is 12 plus 4 is 16. So, yeah, I just got the computer to do the evaluations for me, right? You could do them yourself manually on paper if you wanted. And notice I plotted the dots, and notice there's some symmetry, all right? Notice this side looks like this side if you go boom and straight down through the line of symmetry, all right? So where it bottoms up there in this case is called the vertex. Where it crosses the y-axis here is called the y-intercept. You will always have a y-intercept with a polynomial expression. And notice the vertex goes booming straight down. The line of symmetry goes booming straight down through the vertex. So you can see here that the vertex is at negative 2, comma 0. I'll show you how to get that shortly. So there you go. And notice that there's going to be some symmetry. I'll bet you anything, this dot here is going to be the same height as that, right? So symmetry, look, if this dot here is 3 to the right, because the line of symmetry is at negative 2, if you went 3 to the right, you'd end up at positive 1. If you go 3 to the left, 1, 2, 3, you should end up at the same height. Otherwise, it wouldn't be symmetrical, right? Can you kind of see the type of stuff I'm trying to get home to you, right? So what would this point here be, right? Well, let's see. This point here is 1, 2, 3, 4 to the right of the line of symmetry. So if it's symmetrical, we should be able to go 1, 2, 3, 4 to the left of the line of symmetry, and that should be a 16. Yep, it is. All right. So it turns out that seeing patterns and shapes and symmetries, seeing symmetries and patterns is what math is all about, by the way. All right. So there we go. So hopefully you understand how to do a data table, take an expression, evaluate it, make a data table, plot a few dots, look for line of symmetry, calculate where it crosses the y-axis, the y-intercept. Are we good? Shall we carry on? Here we go. All right, let's pause it. So I plotted a few different graphs here. You know what? You can do them manually if you want, but I put them in that Desmos calculator. All right, so x squared plus 4x plus 4, it looks like that. Negative x squared plus 4. Notice if you put a negative in front of a quadratic, the curve that you get is a sad face. Because negative numbers, the x squared is the trump, so you're going to get more negatives. All right, so if you got a negative in front of the x squared, you're going to have a sad face. It'll open down. And here's another one here. Why is x minus 5 squared? Well, guess what? It's really the same as a plain Jane y equals x, but it just got moved to the right by 5. So if you've got x minus 5 squared, it's the plain Jane y equals x squared, and it got moved to the right. Now, was it the curve that got moved to the right, or was it the grid that got moved to the left? Interesting. And then here's one where we moved it to the right. All right, so here we took a plain Jane, and we dropped it down 5, and then we moved it to the right by 5. We dropped it down by 4, and then we moved it to the right by 5. So there are some patterns here. If you don't quite follow that, that's okay, but I'm trying to show you the type of stuff you might have learned. If you need to focus on more of this stuff, let me know. All right, so there you go. So anyway, the important thing to remember is if you got a negative in front of the x squared term is the trump card, right? It's going to always win eventually because when you multiply something by itself, it gets big a lot quicker. All right, so there's the y equals negative x squared plus 4. Here's the y equals x squared plus 4x plus 4. All right, and there's all that. Okay, so there you go. Hopefully you'll be able to identify the bits that you don't quite get there and we can do it. All right, so guess what? There's my cheat sheet. There's pretty much the entire unit on one piece of paper. Take that to the bathroom when you go for a poop and you'll be laughing. All right, read it on the school on the ride into school. All right, let's have a look at that general form. All right, so the general form of a quadratic equation is the y, or the function, the relationship, is you take some particular value times the x squared plus some other particular value times the x plus some constant at the end. All right, so let's have a look at this. All right, so there's a general form. There's three or four different forms, but there's what we call the general form, or the standard form, I think they sometimes call it, the standard form of a quadratic equation. Now, if this A is less than zero, then you know that it's a sad face. And if it equals zero, then obviously you got a line, right? If there's nothing there, that would just be a line. So if it's less than zero, it's a sad face. And if it's bigger than zero, then it's a happy face. So right away, you can tell the shape of your quadratic formula and the relationship just by whether that's a negative or a positive. And this number at the end is called the y-intercept when you write it in this form, all right? Because guess what? When you cross the y-axis, is your x not a zero? So if I plug a zero in there and a zero in there, right, zero squared and zero squared, you're going to have zero plus zero. So if you want to know, when you write it in this general form, if you want to know what the y-intercept is, it's just that constant number at the end, because all of these terms will disappear. All right, so there you go. So let's do an example. So say you got 4x squared minus 2x plus 5. That's some interesting relationship. All right, so it's going to, well, first of all, you know it's a happy face, and you know it's got a y-intercept of 5. Right away, you could probably sketch it out on an envelope already. All right, so the vertex, let's see. There's your A, there's your B, there's your C. Let's find the vertex. Because once you know the vertex, you know the line of symmetry. And once you know the line of symmetry and you know the y-intercept, you can figure out another point on the other side of the line of symmetry. Oh, I get excited about this stuff. All right, so you're going to take the negative of the B and divide it by 2 times the A. And you'll see why later. And then to find the y-coordinate of the vertex, you're going to take that negative of the b divided by 2a's, and you're going to plug it into the equation, to figure out what the y is that goes with that particular x. Are you with me? All right. So let's do that. So let's calculate the x of the vertex. All right. It's going to be 2 over 8, which is 1 over 4, and we're still going to plug into that. So would you believe 2 over 8 is 1 over 4? Now, I got to take 1 over 4 and plug it into the equation here, all right? Because this equation tells you the y for any x. And I'm telling it, well, I want to know what the y is when I'm on the line of symmetry. So you take the 1 quarter, you plug it in there. Do you know how to do 4 times 1 quarter squared minus 2 times 1 quarter plus 5? Can you do all that? All right, so if you do all that fancy stuff, you're going to have to trust my arithmetic. All right. Oh, I made a boo-boo here. Right, so technically, my boo-boo is technically when you're doing ordered pairs, you're supposed to use round parentheses, not these squiggly brackets. They actually take a mark off on provincial exams if you use the wrong notation and the wrong brackets. So let's calculate 4 times 1 quarter squared minus 2 quarters plus 5. And you know how to do fractions, I hope. And when you do all that stuff, you end up with, boom, 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 here it comes, 4 sixteenths minus 8 sixteenths plus 80 sixteenths. I just made them the common denominator. You end up with 76 sixteenths, which is really 1/4 for the x and 19/4 for the y. And that's, well, if you want to do it in that stupid decimal system, it ends up being that. So I'm saying that's the answer. I'm saying that the vertex for that particular equation is 1/4 step to the left and 4.7 lines down. You ready? Watch this. I'm going to put it in a calculator. You ready? Boom. Oh, look at that. We had it. 1/4 step to the left and 4.75 down. If you put it in a graphing tool. But you know what? You're not allowed to use a graphing tool, are you? Oh, in pre-cal, you just got to do the negative b over 2a and then plug that back into the function itself to figure out the y that goes with the negative b over 2a. Because the negative b over 2a is your line of symmetry. Are you with me? All right. Good. All right, so you can pause this anytime you want. That's easy peasy. So once you understand how to find the line of symmetry, it gets pretty easy to help identify other things. Are you ready? Here we go. Boom. Let me pause here quickly. Okay. I am back. All right. So let's do this general form. Let me give an example then. All right. Let's do this finding the vertex again. Let's do something easier. Let's do y is x squared minus 10x plus 21. All right. So let's find the vertex of that general form quadratic equation. You take the negative of the b divided by 2 times the a, and you then plug that into the function itself. All right, so let's see. That'll give you the x and the y coordinates of the vertex. All right, so let's do that. Now, you got to be pretty good at fractions, obviously. So there's the a, there's the b, there's the c. Let's follow the standard steps here as per my cheat sheet. Hopefully, you're reading this a lot when you go poop. So the vertex is going to be, let's see, the negative of the b divided by 2 times the a. All right. Now, don't forget, it's a negative negative. The b is a negative 10. So you can take a negative negative, which is a positive. So that looks like about a positive 5, right? And then you're going to take that 5 and you're going to plug it into there, 5 squared minus 10 5s plus 21. And all of that's going to end up being 25 minus 5 plus 21. Looks like about 4 in the whole, negative 4. All right, so according to this calculation, by taking the negative of the b divided by 2 times the a and then plugging it back into the function to get the y, and when I put it in that plastic brain I got, the decimal graphing tool, it says that it's positive 5, negative 4. All right, so the vertex is there. Whew, looking good, eh? I kind of like it. I haven't done this in 10 years. This is fun. Thanks a lot. Of course. Now, once you know what the x is of the vertex, you also know the line of symmetry. So you know the line of symmetry once you know the vertex. All right? So let's take x squared plus 4x minus 2. Let's calculate the vertex point. All right, and the vertex point is the negative b over the 2a. So that's going to be, well, negative. It's a positive 4. So a negative 4 divided by a 2 times a 1. That's going to be negative 2, isn't it? And then I take that negative 2 and I plug it back in. And when I plug it back in, I end up with, what's that going to be? Negative 2 squared plus 4 negative 2s minus 2 is going to be 4 plus or minus 8. And it's going to end up being, if I do all this simpler, negative 2, negative 6. All right, so you know the vertex is at negative 2 comma negative 6 right there. Which means the line of symmetry goes booming straight up through the vertex. So the line of symmetry goes straight up the x equals negative 2 line. Right. Nice. Now, what does that do? All right. So that kind of helps you if you're going to do this on the back of a cigarette pack. You could actually do, you don't need a fancy grid. You can do this on the back of a cigarette pack. Now, you know that the y-intercept is negative 2. When the x is 0, the y is negative 2. And guess what? Now, because you know the line of symmetry, you can see the cousin over on this side. Right? So then you'd have this point, this point, this point. You just go zing and just do it on the back of a cigarette pack like that. You wouldn't need all this fancy grid stuff. All right? So notice the y-intercept is the negative 2, because when the x is 0, you're going to have 0 squared plus 4 zeros minus 2 is negative 2, LOL. And now you can find the sister, because if you went 2 to the right and it was negative 2, then if you go 2 to the left, it's got to be negative 2. All right, so if you went 2 to the right of a negative 2, you'd end up at 0. And if you went 2 to the left of a negative 2, you'd end up at negative 4. And this point's going to be the same height as this point because of the symmetry. That's why we call this line of symmetry. So you can pretty much just by looking at this equation, you can probably do this on the back of a cigarette pack and have a really good idea of what it looks like. All right. Anyway, I can show you more of that. Now let's do the vertex form. Some people like this form better. Notice it's a little bit different. Instead of A, B's, and C's, we have A's, H's, and K's. All right. Now some people do it like that, x minus h squared. Depends on what book you look at. So in this case, the vertex is at the H and the K. When you write it like that. All right, let me give you an example. All right, if I said y is 2 times x minus 4 all squared plus 6, it turns out the vertex is going to be at, it's going to be at positive 4 because you take the negative of that. All right, so it's going to be at positive 4. Oh, I'm sorry, when it's written like this, when it's written with the plus, then you take the negative, all right? So it's going to be negative 4, and that'll be the vertex y component right there, all right? Now, depends on what book you're looking at. Some books say that it's a times x plus h, and some books say that it's a times x minus h. So if it's x minus h, you just look at the h. If they write it as x plus h, you got to take the negative of the h. All right, so in this case, you had to take the negative of the 4 to find the vertex x component. A bit confusing, all right? If you do enough practice exercises, you'll figure it out. Let's do another example here, all right? So I'm going to write it in this form. And guess what? When I graph it, when I took that last one we did, 2 times x plus 4 all squared plus 2, all right? Notice it's a happy face because the a is positive, so you knew it was a happy face. And now it doesn't instantly tell you the y-intercept. You can't just take that piece at the end, all right? So it turns out if you want to know the y-intercept, you would have to plug in a 0. So if you want to know the y-intercept for this function, you take 0 plus 4 is 4. 4 squared is 16. 2 16s is 32. Plus 6 is 38. So the y-intercept, you can tell by doing it here, by plugging in 0. 4 squared 16 doubled up is 32. Plus 6 is 38. So you don't just take the number at the end when it's written in this vertex form. All right. And when it's written in the vertex form, you take the opposite of whatever this value is here, and it ends up being negative 4, 6. Now, how do you turn this into the general form? All right, so to turn it back into the general form, you just multiply it out. You remember doing your FOIL, right? First, outer, inner, last, back in grade 9-ish. All right, so x plus 4 squared is x plus 4 times x plus 4. And then don't forget we got that extra 6 at the end. Notice that's a 6. I'll go back and fix it up later. All right. So the important thing is, right, you got the x times the x. Remember how to do FOIL? Firsts, outers, inners, lasts. All right. So, yep. So when you do the FOIL, you end up with that. All right. So all of that noise becomes that. And then I got to add the 6 at the end. That's really a 6, not a 4. I did a transposition error there. All right. So you're going to end up with two bunches of that. When I tidy this up, that's 8 X's. So you're going to end up with 2 X squareds plus 16 X's plus 32. And now that should be a 6. All right. I'll fix that up in a second. And when you do that, it should be 2 more. It should be 38. Look at that. All right. So now if you wanted to check that, you could just say, well, let's do the general form, find the vertex. So you'll take the negative of the b divided by 2 times the a. Then you'll plug that back into the entire function. And it better give you the same answer as that. All right. And if you do it, it works. All right. So there you go. So this is called the vertex form of the function. It's real easy to read the vertex when it's written like that. And it's real easy to convert it to the general form, which is more common, by the way. All right. So there you go. So hopefully you recognize some of that. If not, well, that's the type of stuff we can work on. All right. Hey, let's complete the square. Completing the square. All right. So what the hell does that mean? Well, it means we're going to make a square. So what you do is you pretend you got like one pebble. There's a pebble, and there's kind of like an elastic. We don't know how long it is, so we just say it's X long. So it might be longer, it might be smaller. I don't know how long it is because it's a rubbery elastic piece. But that's just a single pebble. That's just one. And then, of course, if you got something that's X by X, that'd be a big rubber piece of balloon. That would be X squared. And we don't know how long those edges are because it's made of rubber. All right? So let's take something like, these are called algebra tiles, all right? So let's take something like x squared plus 4x plus 4, all right? There's an x squared, and there's 4 x's, and there's 4 little 1's. There you go. There, I just drew it without stupid numbers. Now, you know what? I'm going to turn that into a square. Right now, it's kind of a ugly looking rectangular thing, maybe. I don't know. All right. So watch what I'm going to do. There's the x squared. I'm going to put two of the x's there and two of the x's there. And then where I'm going to put the four? Right there. There. The four pebbles go there. Guess what I just did? I completed a square. That's why we call it completing a square, right? I took all this gobbledygook, all these tiles, and I made them into a perfect square. All right, so now it's x plus two ones along the top and x plus two ones along the side. So it's x plus two, x plus two. We could say it's a square that is x plus two squared. Would you believe that x squared plus four x plus four is the same as x plus two squared? I just showed you that it is. Look. All right. That's called completing the square. Isn't that awesome? It's pretty easy to do with algebra tiles, or you can just sketch it out yourself. Notice I skillfully only had a single x squared. I didn't have like five of them. It gets a bit more complicated when you got five x squareds and you got to start chopping them in pieces and all that. All right. So what did I do there? In order to turn all of that gaggle into a nice bigger square, I took half of the B's, see these are the B's, and I put half of them underneath to extend the shape downwards. And then I just took the pebbles that were left over and threw them into the spots, the empty spots. So that's how I did it. So now let's use that idea to complete the square for anything. Now that you understand that completing the square is just taking a bunch of rubbery sticks and pebbles and turning them into one big square, right? Let's do that now. Are you ready? Here we go. All right. Let's do something like, y is x squared plus 6x plus 2. All right. Can we turn that into the vertex form? Let's turn it into the vertex form by completing the square. All right, so stay with me. I know this is 26 minutes so far, but it's worth it. So there's x squared plus 6 x's. Remember, they're rubbery. We don't know how long they are, plus two pebbles. There we go. All right, can you turn that into a square? All right, let's turn that into a square. So there's the x. And I'm going to put three of the stretchy x's there and three of the stretchy x's underneath. And then I'm going to put all the pebbles in the holes there. And you're going, oh, well, hold on. That doesn't make a perfect square, all right, because you got x plus 3 along the top and you got x plus 3 along the side, but it's not a full square. Pooh. So what you really got there is x plus 3 squared. Take away the 7 that aren't there. See, you're 7 short of an x plus 3 square. Ooh, baby. Don't you love this, all right? I get excited. So you're 7 short of a full, you're 3 bricks short of a full load, right? You're 7 pebbles short of a full square. So it turns out that you could take x squared plus 6x plus 2 and say that's the same as x plus 3 all squared minus 7. And you could always check it by multiplying it back out again, right? So you could take the x plus 3 squared, do the FOIL on it, x squared plus 3x plus 3x plus 9 minus 7, right? X squared, 3x, another 3x plus the 9, and then take away the 7. Surprise, surprise, you could actually convert it back to the x squared plus 6x plus 2. Isn't that fun? All right? We could have fun doing this. So hopefully you recognize some of that. Let's do some more now. So now we can actually solve things. See, so far we were just looking at functions. Now we can actually say, well, when does that function equal a certain value? All right, now we can do lots of fun word problems, but right now we got to get these basic algebra bits out of the way. So now we can solve equations. So when does the function get to a certain value? Let's do one here. I pulled one out of my butt. X squared plus 3x minus 8 equals 2. All right. Now, you know what? I always, always do something on the back of a cigarette pack. What do I mean? Well, first of all, I don't smoke. But you could always be able to take a blank piece of paper and kind of sketch it out. Can you sketch that out? Well, sure you can. Why not? Right? Just take a blank piece of paper or a napkin. So you know that when the x is 0 for this part here, for the quadratic part, you know that the y is negative 8. So you know it goes through there, down at negative 8. So I always, always sketch things out. After a while, you just start to see them in your head. So when the x is 0, the y is negative 8. That's a no-brainer, right? All right. And then now the line of symmetry. Remember how to do the line of symmetry? Remember how you do the negative of the b divided by 2? Well, 2 a's. So that's a 1, so it's going to be negative 3 halves. So you know that the line of symmetry is going to go boom, 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 1.5 steps to the left. You know it's to the left, because if that's positive, then you know the line of symmetry is the opposite. It's going to be negative. All right, so I know the line of symmetry is going to go booming down through here. I'm just kind of doing this like on the back of a cigarette pack. Now, if you know that's there, well, you know it's got a cousin or a sister right there. By symmetry. So you know that point, you know that point. And you know you got a vertex down here, for goodness sake. All right, so boom. I just kind of sketched it on the back of a cigarette pack, for God's sake. All right, or an envelope. So what we're looking for is, when does x squared plus 3x minus 8 equal 2? We're looking for that point and that point. When does this function have a value of 2? Notice there's two answers. The value of 2 is there. And the value of 2 is there. You can almost kind of guess at it just by looking at this sketch, right? All right, so let's do the math then, all right? And we'll use completing the square. All right. So there's what we're looking for. Where do they intersect that line at y equals 2? So what we're going to do is we're going to take half of this 3 and we're going to square it. So half of 3 is what we call 3 halves. Don't call it 1.5. We don't do stupid decimals in pre-cal. All right, so no friggin' decimals in pre-cal. All right, so I'm going to take half of the 3, which is 3 halves, and square it. And I'm going to add it into the pack there. And then we still got the subtract 8 there. Now, if I add 3 halves squared to this side, I got to add 3 halves squared to that side. Remember that rule? Otherwise, it's not the same. It didn't balance. All right, now you know why I added the 3 half squared? I added the 3 half squared because I can now take this and turn it into a nice square. All right, so it turns out by adding b over 2 squared to both sides, I haven't changed the equality, but what happens is this package here becomes x plus 3 halves all squared. Would you believe all of that is the same as that all squared? It's true. Look, aren't you going to have an x times an x? Yep. Aren't you going to have 3 halves of an x plus another 3 halves of an x? Well, isn't 3 halves plus 3 halves 3? So you can have the 3 x's, and then you're going to have the 3 halves times the 3 halves, which is 3 halves squared. So, yeah, kind of like smoke and mirrors. I just added in a number that conveniently turned it into a nice completing the square. Now, of course, I do the same on this side. So on this side, I got 2 plus 9 fourths. You better be good with fractions here. So on this side, I got x plus 3 halves squared minus 8 is equal to, well, what is that? That's how many fourths is that? That's going to be 8 fourths plus 9 fourths is 17 fourths. Are you good with fractions? I imagine you are. All right, now I'm going to get rid of this take away 8 by adding 8 to both sides. So let's see. 8 is really the same as 32 fourths, isn't it? So I'm going to add 32 fourths to both sides. So now I know that all of that is equal to, don't forget the square. All of that is equal to 49 fourths. Now I'm going to unsquare this side and unsquare this side. Now don't forget, when you unsquare something, there's two answers. There's a plus and a minus version, right? A negative times a negative gives you a positive 2. So you're going to end up with plus and minus the square root of 49 fourths. And you know what? That's the same as 7 halves, all right? So now you're going to take away the 3 halves of both sides, and you got plus and minus the square root of 49 fourths, which is really 7 halves, right? Remember how to do that kind of stuff in your surds and rational numbers? So you got two answers there. You got negative 3 halves plus 7 halves, then you got negative 3 halves minus 7 halves. So you end up with 4 halves, or if you did the subtracting, negative 3 minus 7 halves, you'd have negative 10 halves, which is negative 5. So your two answers are going to be 2 and negative 5. So an x of 2 will give you a y of 2, and an x of negative 5 will give you a y of 2. There, that solves the equation. Let's check that. Let's take our 2 and see if it gives us a 2. So let's take 2 squared plus 3 2s minus 8 and see if it gives us 2. Does it give us 2? Woohoo! It did work. So 2 is a solution. Let's check the 5. Let's plug the 5 into here and see if it works. All right? So negative 5 squared is 25 plus 3 negative 5s is going to be negative 15. And then take away 8. What does that equal? Oh, please, God, I hope it equals 2. Let's see. 25 minus 15 take away 8 is... it's 2! Hey, it worked! So our solution worked. Oh, man, we're good. All right, so let's keep going. I know this is 34 minutes already. Here we go. And guess what? When I put it in the plastic brain, it worked. All right, it told me the answers were negative 5, an x of negative 5 gave me a 2, and an x of 2 gave me a 2. It worked. Woohoo! All right. Now, how about the zeros? Sometimes you're interested in when your value is equal to zero. So it's going to be the same steps all over again, except now you just want to know, when does this equal zero? All right? So we call these the zeros or the x-intercepts, or sometimes they call them the roots. So we're going to do the same thing again, but this time we don't care when it equals two. We just want to know when it equals zero. Usually you're interested in when your bank account reaches zero. Normally you're interested in when something that gets shot up hits the ground and it equals zero. All right, so when things equal zero is sometimes an important characteristic. All right, so I took the x squared plus a 3x minus the 8, and I want to know when it equals zero. So I'm going to take half of that square, and I'm going to add 9/4 to both sides. And while I was at it, I added 8 to both sides. I did two steps at once, right? I added 8 to both sides, and I added 9/4 to both sides, all right? So I did two steps at once. And if you do all this, that's going to be 41/4. I'm going to unsquare both sides, all right? So I'm going to end up with plus or minus the square root of 41/4, and then I'm going to move the negative 3/2 onto this side by subtracting, so it's going to be that. And if you know how to do all that stuff, it ends up, there's your answers, 1.70 or negative 4.70. So that point there would be at negative 4.70, gives me a y of 0. And that point there at 1.70 would give me a y of 0. All right, let's just see what it says. Oh, look at that. Hey, it's the same as when I put it in the applied math graphing tool. Too bad you're not allowed to use this in pre-cal, right? It is kind of, this would take 15 seconds to do in applied math. Oh, my goodness, you wouldn't have to do all of this noise. Oh, well, that's the price of doing pre-cal. All right, so that was my very, very quick, hasty exclamation of quadratics and the vertex and the general form about parabolas completing the square. I haven't done this in 10 years. Thank you so much for the fun. Oh, wait. How about the quadratic formula? All right, let's just do, I know this is a 40-minute friggin' movie, but here you go. I wanted to get it all done, mainly to remind myself. Let's figure out where that formula comes from. All right, here we go. Are you ready? You can I would suggest you pause this and slow it down. So let's take the general formula, ax squared plus 4x plus c equals 0. You can always slow me down with the speed button. So we want to equate it to 0. If you want to know, if you want to use the quadratic formula, you just make everything equal to 0. If there happens to be some constant here, you just add or subtract it and put it on that side. So you always start by making things equal to 0. And here's why, right? If I want to get rid of that a, I just divide by a, but then I got to divide everything by a. So I divide the entire left side by a, and of course I can divide this side by a and it's still 0. So that didn't change anything. All right, therefore, right, that's what the three dots mean. Now I've got x squared, because ax squared divided by a is x squared, plus the b over a times x plus the c over a, that equals 0. Are you with me? All right, so now remember what we do. We take this number here, whatever's in front of the x, and we have it. So we divide it by 2, and then we square it. So we have and square it. All right, so we're going to take the b over a, we're going to chop it in 2, and then we're going to square it. And we better do the same on the other side. All right, so boom, are you with me? All right, now you know why we added that, because that value there completed the square. So now we got a complete square on this side. It's bx plus b over 2a squared. You want to multiply it out, right? X times x is x squared. You're going to have half of a bax and another half of a bax, which is a bax. And then you're going to have a b over 2a squared. So it does work out if you FOIL this out. And I'm going to pop the negative. While I'm here, I'm going to pop the negative c over a to that side there, 2a, right? squared. Are you with me? Right, I'm going to tidy it up a bit. Look at this. Look at this. Here we go. All right, now I'm going to tidy this up because, look, we want to have the same denominator. So I got to multiply the bottom here by 4a, and I got to multiply the top by 4a to have the same denominator. All right, so if they're going to have the same denominator, I do that. So pretty good at that, are you? All right, so now I got x plus b over 2a, and I unsquare it. So I unsquare all this noise. If I unsquare all that noise, don't forget, anytime you unsquare something, there's a plus and a minus version. You get b squared minus 4ac all divided by 4a squared. So, of course, you can take that 4a squared up from under the radical of the surd, and you end up with that. Now we're going to pop the b over 2a over onto this side. Woohoo! 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 Oh, baby! Look at her go! So it turns out, if you want to know, when you write something in this general form and you equate it to zero, if you want to know what the x is equal to, once you write it in the general form and equate it to zero, all you got to do is the negative of the b, add and subtract the square root of the b squared minus 4 times the ac, all divided by 2 times the a. Oh, wow. All right, so 40 minutes of that crap. All right, there you go. You can always pause it, rewind it, and if there was something in there you didn't understand, we can do a re-attack on that later. I am done.